Hi, this is David with EdgeStar Technical Support. Today we're going to be talking about the CWD1510W. This is our washer-dryer combo. This is a brand new unit for us, but what we're going to do in the next few segments is we're going to show you how this unit comes apart, some of the common things that can go wrong with the unit, how to actually pull components and repair it, and what maintenance to do and things to look for when you're actually working on the unit. So this will be more of an advanced repair more than anything else. So we're going to go over a lot of things, and we're going to cover a lot of questions about the unit that you may have as a technician. Okay, in this segment we're going to focus on water coming into the unit. So that's where the party starts, so to speak. So, and that comes into these valves back here. Now, as you can see, obviously I've got the top off the unit. I showed you in the previous segment how that comes off. So let's talk about some failure code that could possibly come up here, what to do to resolve it, how to test the valves, and how to take them out. So we have our detergent drawer here up front, our lines that come out of the drawer. We have a line that goes over to the drum, and we have our inlet valves. Now these are commonly known as either a double electro valve and triple electro valve, or more commonly in the industry known as wigwags. So we refer to them here as the double and triple electro valve. But again, if I say wigwag, the technician will know exactly what I'm talking about. So, in this case, what we're going to start with here is an E10 error code. Now, E10 error codes are one of the more common ones that we're going to see. That one has to do with water inlet. And basically what that says is, whoops, I'm taking too long to fill the drum. So, we either have one of several conditions. Either we have a defective valve that's not opening up, it's not getting a signal to open up, the water inlet filter is clogged, or we have an obstruction here in the hoses. So any of those can cause an E10, especially the one that goes over to the drum. If it clogs up with hard water or it's got some sort of foreign object in it, we're going to get that E10 almost immediately, because the system monitors filling of the unit, and it knows that the filling, based on water pressure that's pre-programmed into it, should take only just a few minutes. If it comes outside of those few minutes, it's going to alarm us with that error code that says, hey, we've got something wrong. One of the things that we might run into is using a what they call a flow kit or an adapter kit from your garden hose, from your sink, which is basically your hoses that come in, your garden hose connections here on the back of the unit. It splits it out of the faucet and they come back into the back end of this unit. Just by the nature of that particular device, it may cause a flow rate issue, because it can't flow like two individual water connections can. So as the customer, the first thing that you need to do is determine whether you have this adapter kit, which here's our adapter kit. This is the upper end of it. This connects to our faucet via this disconnecting adapter. And on the other end, we have our hot and cold hoses like we would normally have out of a conventional connection. So, using that splitter may cause a flow issue. That may or may not be the case. So, we need to make sure that our water coming in is good and strong. If that's the case and we've eliminated that, we're going to move to the next step, which is to check our filters. You're going to need a few tools here. I have a power driver here because the bolts that hold these wigwags in, these valves, are pretty tight, and I want to have the extra torque to get them out. Phillips screwdriver, there's a couple of things you're going to need to get to with that hand driver. And we're going to have to test the valves for operation. We're going to use our multimeter set on ohms resistance, otherwise known as a DVOM, digital volt ohm meter. I like to refer to it as the DVOM. We're going to check our connections here. We're going to see how good these valves work electrically with this tool. Unplug the unit before you start anything. Anytime you touch this unit for any other reason other than loading clothes in it, unplug it. All right. So, we've determined that our water supply is okay. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to check our filters. So what we're going to do here is we're going to come back with our needle nose pliers, and I'm going to grab a hold of one of these water filters, and I'm just going to pull it out of the port. So this one's blue. This is our hot side. Need to make sure all these little holes are clean. Scrub it with a brush, whatever you got to do. Try not to poke it out, because if you try to poke out those little holes, well, they stretch the holes out and they mess up the filter. And then you're going to get particles bigger than you want getting into the system. So try not to do that. Just use a little tiny brush, or a little, better yet, use a toothbrush. grab an old toothbrush, scrub it real good, and we're just going to put it back in. So that's our hot side. You're just going to push it all the way back into the valve until it stops. And then we have our cold side. And this is our cold filter. Same thing, except the holes are in here too. This one's going to flow more water than the cold side, or the hot side, because cold is what we normally introduce first. So the filter is a little bit bigger. Make sure everything's clean. Clean it with an old toothbrush and push it back in. Be sure that when you push this back in, that you see which way it came out. Because if you put it in backwards, it's not going to hurt anything, but it's going to be real hard to get out the next time. So make sure it's put in the right way. All right, so what we're going to do now is we're going to assume that our water is good, our filters are clean. Well, what's next? Well, we're going to start checking our valves electrically here. So we're going to come back in here, and I've actually taken this one valve out. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to give you a better bird's eye view. And what you want to do is you're going to want to unplug this one of these connectors. You actually have three triple, that's why they call it a triple electro valve, because we have three. One, two, three. I can't really get down in there too far, but you've got three of these valves and three connections. Make sure you remember which one came off of where, because they're all opened up at different times. If you mix them up, then they're going to open up at the wrong time. And what will happen is we're going to flood the drawer out, or we'll flood the drum out, or it won't fill the drum all the way. So make sure that when you look at this, I would probably take a Sharpie and you could mark on the side of the valve white, you know, W for white, R for red, B for black. If you want to do that, that's fine. But just mark them, because if you hook them up wrong, you're not going to hurt it, but you're going to open these up at the wrong time, and then we're going to have water in places that we shouldn't. And here also, if we have to replace this valve, these hoses come out. So what we're going to do, and I got my handy dandy little pair of pliers here, so what you do to disconnect these hoses, you just come in here, squeeze it, and pull that back. It's just like a car, that one of the hoses on a car, it's the same thing. Squeeze the clamp, push it back along the hose, and pull the hose straight off the fitting. Same over here at the detergent drawer. Three clamps, three hoses, slide the clamps back, pull them off, no big deal. All right, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna check one of these valves. And what you're gonna wanna do is you're gonna set your meter pretty low. So you're gonna set it for ohms resistance. Ohms, just remember that, ohms. And we're gonna start about 200 ohms, because that's, you can always switch it up, that's okay. And this one goes there pretty high, 20,000. We should start probably about the 200 range. So what we're going to do is we're going to come over here. Now that we've got one of these disconnected, we're going to come over here and you're going to put one lead on one and one lead on the other. And that would give us a reading. Usually these are about 140, 180. If you're somewhere in there and you're getting a decent reading, they're okay. If you don't get anything and it shows zero, well, it's bad. You've just confirmed it. It doesn't matter which probe goes to which terminal, because it doesn't care about polarity when we're testing. So all we're doing is checking the integrity of the wiring inside the solenoid, and that's how we do that. So you could switch them around, it wouldn't make any difference. Now, if you're testing for voltage, that's a different story, because one side goes to ground, the other side's hot. But when you're doing ohms resistance, it doesn't matter. And by the way, you can do, and this is for the technician mostly, you can fire up the cycle, and then what you'll do is you'll get your terminals in here, you'll set this for AC voltage, and you should have 120 volts coming out of there. But you could do that, but odds are that you're not going to have a problem with this end of it. It's going to be a problem here in the valve itself. So you can determine that through your ohms resistance check. All right. So now that we've done our ohms resistance check and we figured out our valve is bad, if any of these are bad, any of these three, if one of them doesn't check out, they all got to go. And the reason they all got to go is because, well, that's all one housing. So you need to order your triple electro valve. You'll get this part in the mail through FedEx. And all you'll do is remember which side plugged into where, plug it all back in, and then back here, on the unit, it's probably easier to show it here. You have a screw here and a screw here, You can get those out with your power driver, and then you'll pull this thing inwards, disconnect your hoses, unplug it, and pull it out. That's it. Same with this one. All right, you're going to take this one out the same way. You got two screws at the back, your electrical connection. You check this one the same way for ohms resistance, and then you have a single hose here, same kind of clamp. And this hose goes over here to the top of the detergent box, slide the clamp back, pull the hose off. Same on this end, it's no different. It just happens to be one of these versus three. So that's the only difference. Let's talk about our detergent box a little bit. The detergent box doesn't really need any maintenance. And now I'm going to show you the front end of that box so you can see what I'm talking about. In here there's a release. So to get this out, the drawer faces this way, and it's only going to pull so far because it's going to hit this stop. You're going to push this down, pull the drawer all the way out. So your detergent goes in here. Occasionally what you're going to have to do is come in here and clean out this little float, make sure that's all clear, and you can blow through it. Because that is what gets our overflow down into the drum, because there's a drain underneath the bottom here for that. So you need to make sure all this stays clean. If you don't clean it, residue builds up here, it gets really gunky, then the soap stays in the drawer. It's not going to wash the clothes real well. Pull this out every so often, every few loads, pull it out, scrub it out, rinse it out, put it back in. No big deal. All right, so there's that. Now the carrier that sits in, you may have to remove the carrier for whatever reason. Maybe you have a broken drawer here, somebody forced it, whatever the case may be. So you would take the top off, squeeze your clamps, slide them back, pull the hoses off, and then what you'll find is there's a screw here, right here, and then there's one approximately over in here. So what you'll need to do is take this bar out. You can take your power driver. You have four bolts. You have two here and two over there. Pull those out, pull the support bar out. Then you can get to the other screw that holds this on. Then you're going to pull the detergent drawer casing up and out, and that'll release it from the unit. So there's that. And then of course, when you put it back in, you're going to run your screws in here, make sure that's well supported, and then you're going to come in here and put your bolts back in. And then your control panel has to come off in order to get this out as well, because you have your screws here in the front. So you're going to disconnect your panel. You can let that hang. You don't need to take the wiring loose like I've got here. Just take your panel and let it loose, and then you can slide this out. So remember, you've got the two up front and two over here. Okay, so in this segment we're going to talk about our water pressure sensor, water level sensor, you may call it. That water sensor is right here. Basically what it is there's a diaphragm in here, there's a rubber diaphragm, and that diaphragm has a set of contacts around it. And as that diaphragm moves in and out, it basically senses the air pressure in the drum. The air pressure in the drum will change with the amount of water being let in, so that diaphragm will move back and forth depending on how much air pressure is in the drum. And then what happens is that will send a signal of varying voltage. It varies in voltage, so whichever way that diaphragm swings, it's either more or less voltage, and it will send that to the computer up front. The computer will extrapolate that as either being a problem or everything's okay based on the amount of voltage. For those of you who are mechanics, it's just kind of the same thing as an O2 sensor. It varies in voltage depending on the oxygen concentration in the exhaust stream. Same kind of principle here. So, what we're going to do is talk about this. First of all, I want to talk about trouble codes. Again, we're back to that, because the trouble codes, and they're just like ones on a car. The mechanic pulls the trouble codes. That gives him a place to start. It doesn't mean a be-all and end-all, but it gives us a good place to go. So, and that's kind of the same way here. So, in this one, you could potentially see three different errors. An E10, an E12, or an E33. If you get an E33, I guarantee you 110% that this part is bad, because that says that the water level pressure sensor is inoperative. It has no voltage. The other ones have to do with either too much water in the drum, too little water in the drum. Those could also be caused by what we talked about in the last segment. We may not be getting enough water in the drum because our wigwags, or our inlet valves, aren't opening up enough, they're clogged, you don't have the water turned on hard enough, all of those things. So this system is somewhat interrelated, but all of those codes will generally point to this particular device. So let's say, for example, we get an E33. We know for a fact that this is bad based on that error code. So we've got to remove it. So what you'll do is you'll call customer service and order the part. And here's how you get this out of here. The first thing you're going to do, there's a pressure sensor hose that attaches to the bottom of the unit. And what you're going to do is go back there and feel for it. And you're going to wiggle it and pull it off. And there it is right there. The clamp doesn't hold real well. It doesn't really need to. There's enough of a tight fit here that that's sort of kind of a moot point. But this hose goes down to the bottom of the drum, and that's where we get our air pressure. Our air comes up through this hose, and that pushes up on this bellows, and then that changes our electrical contacts inside this switch. So basically what this is an air-operated switch, because the air comes in and moves the switch contacts. Easy enough, right? So we disconnect our hose, we unplug our sensor connector, and then we take our wonderful little power driver, and you get it up on this screw right here. You're going to pull the screw, and there it is. So, and you'll see what looks like water in there. That's actually not water. What these are adjustments for the sensor, and they've been sealed off. They've got epoxy. You can't get those out. You don't ever want to adjust this. So if it's bad, it's just bad. So what you would do, you're going to use this bracket. I don't think that the bracket comes with a new sensor. I think it's just the sensor itself. So what you would do here is you're going to take a pair of needle-nose pliers, and what we're going to do is we're going to squeeze that, and then work this clamp, this bracket off. So, and it slides right off. So you're going to squeeze these shut, and then we'll slide that bracket down and off of there. So I'm not going to do that, but that's how you do it. And that, now that sensor may come with a bracket. If it does, fine. If it doesn't, well, you've got the bracket. So to put that back on, first thing you're going to want to do here, you're going to want to hook everything up first. So you're going to come back down in here and grab your hose. And slide your hose on just like that. Flip it around. Plug it in. And then you put your screw back in, and you've replaced your sensor. All right, so this morning we're going to take a look at our blower motor here. This provides airflow through the heating element and into the drum. So, one may ask, well, what happens when this motor fails? Well, it can fail in one of two ways, and we're going to see a various amount of symptoms based on what goes on. So, the motor can electrically fail where the windings in here go bad and it shorts, or it can jam up, something gets stuck up in here, which is highly unlikely, but you may get something up in here where it jams that fan and then the motor can't turn and then it physically comes apart. So you can have physical damage and you can have electrical damage. It's not unlike any other motor out there today. So when this goes bad, basically what happens is, because we don't have any airflow over our heating element in here, this is going to overheat. It has to have airflow in order to keep it at a constant temperature. If that airflow stops, our safety thermostat here will kick out, kill the power to the element. The unit's going to pop an error code for the drying element, and your clothes aren't going to dry. And that code is an E3A. And that basically says that, hey, I'm not drying. I don't have any heat going on up here. And again, because we don't have the airflow going over the element overheats, pops our high limit thermostat, that opens the circuit, and then the computer sees that, pops the error code, and you don't have any dry clothes. So that's kind of the sequence that we go in. And we're going to talk about the element in another segment. We'll get into that. I'll show you how all that is torn down and gotten into. But for purposes of this, basically if this motor fails, what you can do, and as a technician, by the way, what you would do here is, this is your connector for the blower motor. So what you're going to do is you're going to disconnect this, and what you're going to do is go in there with a meter and you're going to do an ohms check for resistance. So you would see that basically on this case, which I don't have the specs for it, but in this case, if it has any resistance at all, it's a known good part. If it doesn't have any resistance, then we know it's bad. So you basically would just back probe here, and back probe here on the other side and set it for ohms resistance, we should get a reading out of it. So if you get any reading at all, the motor's good. If you get nothing, it's open and bad and needs to be replaced. So with that being said, now that you've made the determination about whether the motor is bad or not, and you've done an electrical check, you've done a physical check, if a motor goes bad as far as electrically, we also have our sense of smell, and we can smell what burning windings smell like, and they don't smell very good because there's varnish in here on the windings, and what happens is the varnish burns. And when varnish burns, it creates a characteristic odor, and you can usually smell it long before you ever see it. So if you notice that it's not drying and it's popping an error code, or you could smell something burning, odds are it's this motor here, and that needs to be replaced. So the first thing that we're going to do to get this out is you have some perimeter screws, and they're here, 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 over here, and you got one here. There's also a ground strap here, which you may, if you actually completely remove the motor, you need to take the ground strap loose, come over here, take the zip tie, and you're going to cut it. That'll free your motor lead up, and then you can pull the whole thing up and out of the unit. Be advised, though, when you do this and you take these perimeter screws out, you've got this other hose coming off this wigwag here, this inlet valve. So what you're going to need to do is pop it up and out of the clips. Some of these clips will stay. These two back here in particular, they can stay on the hose, and that's fine. Just don't lose them. Don't drop them down inside the unit, because unless you have a magnetic pickup, they can be pretty difficult to retrieve. So what you're going to do is once you get all those bolts out, you're going to pull straight up and back a little bit, and that will clear, and you may have to pull this back a little bit, and that will clear our rubber opening here, and then we have our fan. So this is the underside of the fan, and this is the housing for it. The housing will stay in place. You shouldn't ever have to remove the housing, although you can, but you shouldn't have to. And this is our motor and our fan here. And this fan is aluminum, so you should never have any problems with breakage as far as the fan is concerned. Down inside of here is our inlet to our drum. And you want to make sure that you do a physical check down in here. And you can take a flashlight and just come down in here and you can just shine it down in there and check and make sure that you don't have any obstructions. Because what can happen is if we get a big chunk of lint or something that gets sucked up in there, it'll stay down in this opening, and you're going to have to go in there and with a piece of wire coat hanger or some other object or a pair of needle-nose pliers, really long pair, which I don't have, and you're going to reach down in there and you just grab it and pull it out. So the odds of that happening are pretty slim, but I can tell you over time, you will see some lint build up in here, and you're going to see it back up in here on the element. Probably once every 2 or 3 years, I would probably, just as a maintenance check, pull this and pull this upper housing for this heater plenum and clean it all out. You can just blow it out with compressed air, and that will prevent any problems in the future with maybe lint buildup. If we get enough lint that builds up on this motor, it can restrict the airflow, and what will happen is that motor, with the restricted airflow and not flowing enough air over the element, could potentially cause our high limit thermostat to kick out, and then we're not drying. So that usually happens gradually. That happens over a period of years. So if your customer complains and says, hey, it's been drying great for years, but now it's not drying real well, first thing I would do is pull this housing, check down in here for accumulated lint, pull this top other piece here, which I'll do in another segment, and we can check that out and blow it all out, make it nice and clean, and put it back, and it's probably fine. So if you have to replace the motor on this one, I can tell you that this should come as a complete assembly. The hood, your fan, and your motor itself and the leads coming off of it will come as one piece. So it's basically a drop, plug, and play. That's it. So in our next segment, we'll cover the heating element and how all that works. All right, in this segment, we're going to talk about the air drying element itself. Now, there's several different things that are going on here all at once. Typically, with a bad element in here for your drying, we're going to pop a code E3A, and that basically tells us that one of two things have occurred. Either the element itself has gone bad and actually opened up, or one of our thermostats has opened up for an abnormal condition, which would cause it not to dry. And if you remember, in the last segment I talked about blockages and the fan not working, and how those all work in conjunction with the element, and how those can also cause the same code to pop because we don't have any airflow over the element. So in this case, we're going to assume that our element itself is defective, and we've made that determination by checking our element here for resistance, and this should have probably 10 to 12,000 kOhms. These are pretty high. So you should have 10, 12, 15,000 kOhms. If you have a really low ohms reading or it's nothing, if you've only got a couple of thousand kOhms and it's not working, or you have an open condition where it's infinity, it's reading zero, odds are pretty good that that element is bad and it's broken, it has a broken element. And by the way, the element's the same kind of element you'll find on like a electric stove. It's the same type of element. It's called, they call a Calrod element, and it's different, made of different layers. We have our wire inside the first layer, and then on the outside we have wraps which are made of metal, and they basically dip the wire in a progressive sequence, and it builds up at the factory. When they dip the wire into the solution, it adheres to it, and every time they dip it, it gets a little bigger and a little bigger, so it does it in layers. But what can happen is the conducting wire inside the element can actually break over time, either through age or being dropped or handled roughly, or even a power surge could potentially cause that wire to burn in two. And you won't, because the way the Calrod element is set up and the way it's encased inside the element, you'll never see a broken wire. They make these wires in different forms. Your electric stove is more flat, but the process is the same. This one's more of a round shape, but the process for manufacturing is the same. And again, they're referred to as a Calrod element. That's the trade name that GE used for their stoves for years and years. As a matter of fact, they continue to use that same trade name. So, first thing we're going to do is we're going to check our element for resistance. Your element is actually right here, and you can denote that because we have a rubber seal here, and that protects our contacts internally and externally from contacting our housing here, which would cause a direct short. So it's protected. So what you would do is a double check. You can fire up the unit and double check it for voltage here. We should have 120 volts go into these two. Doesn't matter which one when you check an AC voltages like that. Wouldn't make any difference. Most DVOMs are self-correcting and it would end up being a negative indication, which is okay. It doesn't really matter. So the first thing you would do is check that for voltage. If that pans out, what we're going to do next, we're going to take our DVOM, we're going to set it for resistance, and you can do this either one. Again, when you're doing resistance checks, it doesn't matter on polarity, so we would check that. And again, you should be getting 12 to 15,000 kOhms. It should be super high. It might even be higher than that. I don't have the specific specs here, but as long as you're getting a really good amount, what you think it should look like, and speaking of technicians, you should know. So as long as you're getting roughly what you think you should be getting, it's fine. If you suspect it's low or you have an infinity reading, it's open and needs to be replaced. With that being said, we're going to get into our thermostats here. Now you have two different stats here. And basically what we have is we have an operating thermostat and we have a safety thermostat. And the way this works is that the power has to flow through the safety thermostat first. Our safety's down here at the bottom, it's these black ones. This is our operating thermostat. So this one would get fed power first from our main circuit board, our cluster of spaghetti here, and it will get power from that. And that feeds back to the main computer and says, okay, I'm okay here, temperature's within spec, go ahead and fire up the element. And when it does, it's gonna sit there and monitor it. And as long as that temperature remains in a predefined value, it'll continue to operate. If it sees any abnormal condition, it's going to shut down the element. For example, this is an illiteration. If you take a hairdryer and you cover both sides of the intake on a hairdryer, you ever notice how the coils glow real red? Well, they're not getting any airflow, so they're overheating. You normally wouldn't see it glow. It gets just hot enough to dry these coils, and it shouldn't get any hotter than that. If it gets red hot, then we've got a failure in here with one of these thermostats, and that normally wouldn't happen. It has an ultimate fail-safe where it would shut down before it ever got that hot. So that's not a concern. So our power comes into the safety thermostat. It says, I'm okay. So then it switches power over to our operating thermostat. So both of these are supplied power the entire time. If this one detects an abnormal condition, it shuts off power to this one and shuts off power to the element and kills it off here and at the source where these wires come out to power the element. So that's all done as a safety check for you. You can check these thermostats. We need to talk about that next, and then we'll get into the element. And I'm going to plug this back up just so I don't lose my place here. Now, you want to note the orientation of these wires. So we have one black and one blue. So make sure that you put these back in the same order that they were in. So black on the bottom, blue on the top in this case. What you would do is you would do that same ohms check here and the same ohms check here. If you're getting a reading out of this one, you're getting a reading out of this one, they're both good. If they read infinity, they're bad and they got to go. If you have to get this one out, there's two screws here, one on each side. You're going to pull those, and this sits in a little rubber grommet, and you're just going to wiggle it out. And then you'll wiggle the new one in, line up your screws, and put your screws back in. This one's no different, same thing. So you pull both of those screws, wiggle it out, wiggle the new one in, put your screws back in, and plug it up. That's it. So, again, check both of these. Check both your safety thermostat and your operating stat, and check your resistance on your leads here before you condemn anything. Now that we've done that, we're ready to get into the meat of the matter here and pull this plenum. Now, in order to do that, you're going to need to disconnect your wires here, because on this one, that thermostat stays up in that top housing. Over here, we have a couple of different sensors, but I'll talk about that in a minute. I want to get this case open. So what you're going to do, down here below the control panel, you'll find two screws, one on each side. Screw here, here. Here, here, and here, and then you've got one over here. And by the way, this motor has to come out because of the way these two covers interlock together. There's a rubber seal right here. So what you need to do is pull this one loose, and you can just let it hang. And then what you're going to do is you're going to grab it in here, because what happens is this rubber seal will tend to get a little tough over time. It, even when it's new, it's tough getting it off. So what you're going to do to get some leverage, it's just like breaking open a valve cover. So what we're going to do is we're going to get all these screws loose. We're going to pull straight up and slide it out. Now, as you can see, our thermostat stayed with our cover. And it's a blind hole in here. The sensor doesn't actually protrude into the cover. It just senses the temperature of this cover. And this is all cast aluminum. Now that we've got our cover up, we have access to our element. So as you can see, it's just a round element. It's a lot like a hot water heater element. Kind of reminds me of this, what they call a sand hog on a water heater element. They have a lot of twists in them. And the reason they do that is because the more twists they have, the less they build up calcium. Just because of their shape. And they call them sand hogs for that reason. So what you can do to take that element out, now that you, let's say you verify that this element is bad, you're going to disconnect this here. Take your wires loose, and by the way, and I forgot to mention it, you got a ground wire that goes here, and you got another ground wire coming off that motor, and it goes here or here. It's just wherever you can make it work. It doesn't have to go in back in exactly the same spot, but it does need to be anchored to this cover. So, with that being said, we're ready to pull our element. Now, in order to do that, we're going to need to grab our trusty Phillips screwdriver. You've got two hold-down screws here in the center. And we're just going to pull those out. And try not to lose your screws. And these are pretty short, so you're going to want to kind of hold on to this thing. All right, so we've got that out. So what you're going to do is you're going to come over here and use a little leverage and pry it out. So there's our element. And when you order the element, this is what you're going to get. Now your brackets down here, you're going to have to transfer those from the old element over to the new one. So now that we've got that loose, now we can clean all this out, and I would advise a thorough cleaning of this whole under housing here so that you can get to that. So in order to put this back in, what you're going to do is you're going to line up here in your housing. You're going to get your rubber grommet back in, and you're going to have to slide these screws over, and then you're going to put your screws back in and line everything up. And once you're done, you'll put your cover back on. While I've got this cover off, let's talk about our sensors here. And these sensors, these are humidity sensors. Now there's two of them. There's one at the beginning of the airflow and one after the airflow, because the computer monitors the humidity to make sure that the clothes dry correctly. So it knows the incoming air that comes in, which is down in here. What happens is that it monitors the humidity coming in, and it monitors the humidity going out. So when it does that, it knows that the decreasing humidity coming in from the dry side, we know that dry cycle is progressing. So if we don't have consistent readings from both sensors, then we're going to have problems with the dry cycle. So here's what the sensor looks like. And all they do is they change resistance with temperature. So what you do is they just slide into these rubber grommets. And they don't really slide too easy. They kind of have to, you really have to work them in. But they sit inside the housing. And you've got another one down here at the intake. And there's your other sensor for the humidity. Now to disconnect these, what you're going to do is you're going to have to get in here, and you've got a little tab here to depress, and then it disconnects. And you can also check these for resistance. So you would use your ohms meter again, and you're going to probe those two, and you should have resistance on it. Same with this one, it's no different. You should have resistance on these. If you don't have anything, they're open and they need to be replaced. So what we're going to do now is we're going to just pop this back in there. And then on this one, it sits down here on the side of the intake, and all you do is push it through the rubber boot. Make sure it's seated real good. It's just like the IAT on a car, an intake air temperature sensor. It sits in the air box. It's the same thing, same principle. Basically, it's the same sensor. And that's what your computer uses to monitor the air fuel mixture when you're first starting the car up. So same thing here, and again, your thermostat sits in here, and this one actually has a cutout in the side of the housing, and the sensor doesn't really protrude through the housing, but it sits almost flush with it. So again, you have your bimetallic thermostats, your safety, your operating stat, which is attached to this cover, and all of that stuff works in conjunction with each other, along with the blower motor, to make sure that the drying experience works like it should. I hope that this do-it-yourself video has helped you to repair and maintain your CWD1510W combo washer-dryer unit. If you have any questions or concerns, please contact EdgeStar at www.edgestar.com.